thank Nina for helping us with that video and all the students. As you are probably well aware, we are studying the book of Song of Solomon, or Song of Songs, and we're in chapter 7 and 8. So go to chapter 7, Song of Songs, chapter 7. As you find your way there, I just share with you, as I look out among us, I see a lot of lovely faces, people that I've grown to care about, a few that I don't know. I acknowledge that my parents are here today, which are just fantastic people. Those of you that know them already know that. If you don't, you should get to know them, and your day gets better like that. So you're welcome to do that. And we're celebrating my wife's birthday this weekend. So, and as a way of celebration, I won't make any more of that than than what I just did, and she'll be pleased. But as I think about who's here today, I think okay, so I noticed the children. I am so glad that there are children in our community. Little babies that cry. Grade schoolers and toddlers and junior hires and high schoolers, and it gets more and more confusing to figure out where that category gets cut off these days. I want to say again what we have said over the last few weeks, and that is, parents, we not only respect but encourage your decision making as we travel through the pages of Song of Songs. And if there is some part that you're uncomfortable with, or you just feel like this would be a good time to go out and talk a little, you're welcome to do so. But I want to say to the children, before I move on to any other groups that I notice here, I am so delighted that you are here. I am so glad that your conversations around sexuality, whenever they begin or however, whatever course they take, will not be relegated or stuck just with what you see on TV or in a movie, but that you have a community here who is courageous enough to spend some time talking about it and invite you to ask the questions that you're confused about, interested in, of your parents and meaningful adults who can be trusted. And maybe the television won't raise you in the sexual thinking and development of your life, or maybe you won't be raised by another grade schooler who has an idea about sexuality that is, of course, based on years and years of research. The group that will find themselves quite comfortably at home most quickly, most initially, are those that are married in the room. And I want to say how important I think marriage is in the journey of humanity. And so you'll find yourself clearly there. But you know what? We don't wear signs about our marriage on the outside, do we? Some of us are in marriages that are struggling. Some of us are in marriages that are healthy. Wherever your marriage is right this minute, you will find yourself in the pages that we look at. There are others in that single category spread across the ages, right? You could be a 20-year-old or an 18-year-old and dating and exploring and experimenting with what this is all about. The conversation around sexuality is absolutely yours to hear and to understand and make decisions about. Some, of course, we could dice that category up, couldn't we? Those who have a lot of experience in the area of sexuality already, those who have none, those who wonder if they'll ever be chosen by another. And of course, that's not just 18 or 20-year-olds. That could go all the way through the ages. Or it could be that you have a marriage that has broken and ended, or a marriage that, in fact, has experienced death, and you are now, again, redefined. You are in the right place today. It could also be that you're somebody who, on the subject of sexuality, the subject of marriage, you're somebody that you suspect of yourself that that's not something that's going to be a part of your journey. I just want you to know you're in the right place. And if it seems like we're talking to one group of people for 1 minute, be patient. We're all in the right place on this conversation in Song of Songs, chapter 7 and 8. So you've found your way to chapter 7. And if you don't mind, I will carefully read from the New International Version the first few verses, and then we'll have a word of prayer to ask God's blessing over our conversation. Chapter 7, Song of Songs, chapter 7, verse 1. How beautiful your sandaled feet, O prince's daughter! Your graceful legs are like jewels, the work of a craftsman's hands. Your navel is rounded, a rounded goblet that never lacks blended wine. Your waist is a mound of wheat encircled by lilies. Your breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle. Your neck is like an ivory tower. Your eyes are the pools of Heshbon by the gate of Bathrabim. Your nose is like the Tower of Lebanon looking toward Damascus. Your head crowns you like Mount Carmel. Your hair is like royal tapestry. The king is held captive by its tresses. How beautiful you are, and how pleasing, O love, with your delights. Let's bow our heads. Father, this somewhat more rare territory of your word we explore today. Under the promise of the presence of your Spirit, bless us, grow us, include us. Help us to know you better. And God, maybe there's somebody that needs healing or encouragement. Maybe perspective. Maybe hope for the joy of what you have in store. Through your Spirit, give us exactly what you came here to give. And we, in exchange, submit to you our hearts. In Christ, amen. Well, I was thinking about how to title what we're going to talk about today, and there are a couple of different titles that went through my head. One is just simply the word breasts. Fairly central to chapter 7, either the outright word or a metaphor for the word. It comes up pretty regularly. You know, there are different kinds of amens, and I know of at least three. There's the one, there's the amen that is kind of, yeah, you should be thinking about that yourself, brother, and that's kind of a little amen. Then there's the amen of, okay, all right, preach. Then there's the amen of exactly what I was thinking. Not sure which we're dealing with over here, but you're welcome to give all of those. I thought about actually titling it this: Sex is Good. No, I'm not done with the title. Sex is good. Really, really good. Amen. There you go. This is an awkward place for us to read sometimes. I would have to tell you, I think that it's great for us to notice this is the language of married sexuality. This is Song of Songs, King Solomon and wife. Had somebody ask me, yeah, it just is kind of disconcerting to think of, well, okay, so which one again? So not a concubine, what do you? Solomon definitely gets into a whole different way of thinking. And if you look at it, and we won't spend time now, he gets into an awful lot of trouble once he goes there. This is pre that. But it's all right here. And by the way, as you read it, do you think to yourself, oh, that's a good one. Tuck that away. I'm going to be using that one real soon. No, seriously, I'm just saying. You have wheat belly. Something like that. It worked for him. I'm just trying. And your nose, I'm going to just say tower-like. But here he goes. Graceful legs. He's doing all right with that, don't you think? The work of craftsmanship. Starts to get a little different. Your navel is rounded goblet that never lacks blended wine. We could get a little literalistic there and wonder what in the world's going on. Your waist is a mound of wheat encircled by lilies. Your breasts are like two fawns of a gazelle. Your neck like an ivory tower. Your eyes, the pools of Heshbon by the gate of Bathrabim. Your nose, the tower of Lebanon. And on it goes. And then verse 6, how beautiful you are and how pleasing, O love, with your delights. Doesn't stop there. Your stature is like that of the palm. Now again, have you noticed that, I'm not even sure how complimentary most of these are, right? I mean, so okay, your stature is like that of a palm. Really skinny and then just. Yeah, I don't know what's going on with her hair, but it's tapestry stuff. Stature of the palm, like that of the palm. Your breasts like clusters of fruit. I said, I will climb the palm tree. I will take hold of its fruit. May your breasts be like the clusters of the vine, the fragrance of your breath like apples, your mouth like the best wine. And here it transitions to her voice. He just said, your mouth like the best wine. And she says, may the wine go straight to my lover, flowing gently over lips and teeth. I belong to my lover, and his desire is for me. You know, as I was reading this, and as we've been reading quite a number of things, one of the things that's kind of come back to me with some regularity is, and this is generalization, but the difference between men and women on some of this. You notice that the gentleman, when he's talking about her, he talks in very descriptive language of things that he could see, right? And this is true. Men's sexuality often has ties to how we see or what we see. But he finds it in his heart to translate this into words of meaning. And I'm suspicious that he doesn't even think that, you know, the pools of Heshbon necessarily are sexy. That the Tower of Lebanon is, I mean, that's go time words there. But here's what happens in marriage that's different than if you're just trolling around out there in the world, right? If you're out there, you have to use very specific, well-known code words if you're going to try to, you know, connect on a sexual level with another person. But they're fairly shallow and meaningless. These words, I've got to guess, have stories behind them. Has she actually been in the pool of Heshbon? Did they go there together? Does this have trigger language? Every married couple in the room right now could resonate with this. You have little statements that you could say to one another in a room of people that others would not understand. Code language, so to speak. Things that are triggers. And that person over there might not think that's, you know, intimate talk, but you know what you're doing. And it matters and is meaningful, and that's part of what is going on here. That Solomon is speaking words that he has thought about, and there are connections to. This one little thing that I've learned over some time, that matters a lot to my wife. A level of thoughtfulness, meaning, and shared experience. What a contrast, by the way, to the world around us. It seems to be feeding and selling a lie that, in fact, what makes for the greatest intimacy, the best moments are those that are the first time, right? That's going to be the big deal, the first time. And if you're selling the first time as the big deal, then what do you have to do? You're going to have a bunch of first times. And in fact, if you go to kind of the grocery store of media and television and ad campaigns and so on, it's that first connection. That's what really sells it. It's what's right out there on the surface. That's the good stuff. And the grocery store aisles of sexuality don't have many shelves on it that include things with a lot of marital satisfaction, long-term commitment, and deeper levels of meaning. want to suggest to you the hints right here of even these weird descriptions that don't sound interesting to me sounded interesting to her because of their shared experience. You know, a couple weeks ago, Susan was talking about some of the tragedy of sex trafficking and so on, and I was sitting right over here, I felt myself wonder, is the world so broken in the area of sexuality, partly because when you go down through the shopping area of what's available in sexuality in the world around us, there is so little in the grocery store that is the good stuff. There's so few people talking about great, good sex. So if you're interested in it, you pretty well got to go to the bad stuff. Research suggests that the most sexually satisfied people in the room here right now are not 20. A couple weeks ago, I, as some of you might have been here, I announced, I didn't realize it was going to be such a, it's kind of an announcement, but I shared that I am sexually active. My wife was not able to be here that particular day. By the time she and I saw one another, somebody had texted her that I had announced that I am sexually active. That was not the only person to make sure she heard that I had announced that I was sexually active, which, I just to clear one thing up, that was not news to her. She was really, really aware of that. Do you know, research suggests young married couple, how many of you are within 1 year of marriage? Anybody been married for a year or less? Okay, right here we have some. We have any others? How about within 2 years of marriage? Yeah, we got another. Okay. Research suggests that you're nowhere really near your fullest sexual fulfillment. Isn't that great news? No, that doesn't mean you're in some bad state right now. I'm telling you, it will get even better. Every once in a while, as I walk around or I listen to younger people, and I've worked with high schoolers, and boy, you want to weird high schoolers out. Tell them, hey, I've had sex. I know that because my daughter's in this class, it should have been apparent to you, but I have had sex. Oh! We're really, really comfortable when my fellow 15-year-old describes to me how this works, based on their vast knowledge. But if the people who actually legitimately under the sight of God are encouraged to be sexually active were to talk about it, that gets weird fast. And we leave the conversation to the world. You know, it's interesting. The Jewish view of sexuality as a religion, as a worldview, Judaism is sex positive. In fact, they consider a married couple having sex a mitzvah. Do you know what a mitzvah is? Anybody? A blessing? In fact, beyond that, it is a good deed done out of, and is in fact your religious duty. So, young 15-year-old, God expects your parents to be having sex. Oh, no. In fact, and by the way, you should understand that the Jewish understanding of sex is it's pleasurable, yes, and that's good all on its own. It is absolutely a part of the human experience of bearing children absolutely necessary for that, in fact. And then finally, it is a part, this is a Jewish understanding, it is about as a part of how two people actually really could, in the most full way, understand one another. To really know one another. And so it is not just this one little thing, it is all of this. So much of which you cannot experience outside of commitment. And I mean real, complete, equal commitment. One rabbi suggests that if you only make love once a week as a married couple, that's the bare minimum, by the way, in terms of Jewish reckoning, once a week. But if you're going to do it only once a week, for goodness sakes, at least do it on the Sabbath. In fact, having sex on the Sabbath for a Jew is a double mitzvah. It doubles the good deed and is religious duty. If you're going to observe Sabbath, at least have sex. How does that ring with any kind of puritanical kind of feelings we might have sometimes? That idea was first, by the way. You know, it's interesting, there's an author named Kevin Lehman who writes and counsels with marriage and so on, couples, who's written a book called Sheet Music, which I'll give this one little disclaimer, it's zesty. In fact, I think he has a section that he encourages people who are not actually married to wait to read, just because of the zest involved. But one of the quotes from this book that I particularly love is this. He says, "The more I counsel couples, the more I believe in God's request that we engage in no sex before marriage and lots of great sex after marriage." And it causes me to wonder if one of the reasons it's so hard for some of us not to have sex before marriage is because we're not so sure it's all that great after. But if you were to pin me down and just say, okay, we're going to divide people into groups. We're going to have 20 to 25-year-olds, and we'll just go by five-year increments, and we'll have them all stacked here. So now I'm not pointing at any one person, but I'm pointing at an age group. And you would say, who do you think in the room are the most sexually satisfied individuals? I promise you I would not be pointing at the 20 to 25-year-olds. And I'm not alone in the research. Older people are more satisfied, older than 20 to 25. I'm not trying to suggest that if you can reach 100, there you have it. Although it's a goal to shoot for, don't you think? Set the bar high. I think of it a little bit like this, you know, sometimes this idea, and by the way, this should take the pressure off of certain kinds of things, right? For instance, the marriage night. And even if you've been engaged sexually before this, the pressure builds for that marriage night to be the night, right? Guess what? It's not the end. It's the beginning. There is no way you could be as good at it, as understanding, as aware, or receive the kind of enjoyment, partly because it's not just about the physical act. It's not just about saying, you know, your head crowns you like Mount Carmel with hair like curtains. It's about that there is some shared experience there about Mount Carmel that would mean something to you. My wife is sitting right over here, and every once in a while you'll see me glance over there because out of everyone in the room, the one I hope for approval on this conversation and subject is seated right there. And there are things that I could say right now that would be deeply complimentary to her that you would not understand in the slightest way because you've not been there as we discipline our children. You've not been there when we started dating. You've not been there as we've gone through pain. You've not been there. We have. And there is this knowing bit that changes everything. So I'll just make a couple of base statements. For instance, I know I'm better at it now than I was. Is that counterintuitive to you in any way? I'm sorry, I think in sports metaphors all the time. You know, the idea that a basketball team would perform better if they just kept changing teammates all the time is ridiculous. A great team sometimes is great, not because the individuals are so great, but because they work together so well. There's a decent chance when you get to be 50 like me, you might say, I have never been more sexually satisfied in my life. And it will mean so, so much more. Yeah, when I told my wife when we got married that I love her, it was absolutely true. It just could not possibly mean what it means today. And here's what's interesting. You know, I look back at the 20-year-old me, the 24-year-old me that married my wife at that time. I look back at who he was, who he thought he was even, and I have a little smile. Isn't that cute? And on the subject of sexuality, I mean, for real. I mean, that's nice. What do you think I'll think about this moment in 1,000 years? Oh, what he didn't know. Sure, I'm glad he understood and took God at his calling to be with this one woman and let this 1,000 years play out. Because it's so much better. They know each other. By the way, some research suggests that Christian married couples are having the most satisfying sex on the planet. Interestingly, it's the same group who tends to talk about it the least. And so our young people aren't so clear that that's even a possibility. I went looking, and boy, you can find that there are health benefits to sex. Did you know this? Apparently, it helps your immune system, because there are higher levels of immunoglobulin A that are released. Apparently lowers your blood pressure, typically. It can contribute to lesser risk of heart attack, balance out estrogen and testosterone levels, may lessen the incidence of prostate cancer for men. And for women, improve bladder control, which 30% of the women in this room, apparently by research, are going to struggle with. And probably not tell you. Sex counts as exercise. How awesome is that? Maybe need to be doing more of it, but I'm just saying. It eases stress, the endorphins, the oxytocin that are secreted. Gives you greater self-esteem, improves happiness, elevates the mood, decreases depression. It improves sleep. Because of the release of prolactin. Lessens pain. In fact, I read one little article that says the next time you're tempted to say, I've got a headache, I'm sorry, you may want to pause and look at the research, which actually suggests that the release of endorphins, especially during orgasm, are equivalent to releasing morphine. And a nap may not give you nearly the recovery that sexual activity would. In fact, in one research study, sexual activity was seen to lessen migraine headaches and in some cases even eradicate them. Count me in. There's this one, a study that suggests that regular sexuality helps you look younger. Regular? 3 to 4 times a week. Which, by the way, single people and non-married cohabitating individuals, those groups have less sex than married people do. It's fascinating, the idea of people living together, because often one of the conversation points is, well, we kind of want to see if we're sexually compatible. Studies show it is a terrible move, by the way. First of all, divorce rate of people who have checked whether they would be compatible is horrific. Almost twice the regular divorce rate. And then if you compare that to the divorce rate of people who are virgins at marriage, which is really, really small, that divorce rate there, essentially what we're saying is when you check out whether you're sexually compatible, you will be way more wrong about it than if you don't check. Interesting. People who cohabitate, much more likely to abuse their partner, and the abuse is worse, more severe. Higher levels of depression, it goes on and on and on. Apparently, I don't know, could it be God knew something that turns up in the research to be true? You look younger, wow, how much younger? Well, this particular group is, a study in Scotland. 3 to 4 times a week, comparing with a control group, when estimating how old those individuals were, they benefited on the younger side 7 to 12 years, wrongly estimated. Did I make that suitably unclear? Mental sharpness. I haven't heard this talked about a lot, but apparently there's increased blood flow to the brain in sexuality. Yeah, you can't use it as an excuse for not thinking about blood flow. And of course, how about this one? It boosts your libido, which of course gets back to all these other things, right? Having sex apparently contributes to you wanting to have sex. Interesting. And finally, it has a really strong and positive effect on intimacy. Oxytocin that is released helps us bond and build trust and feel open and be more honest and communicate more regularly and more deeply. And all of that creates a cycle, right? Now imagine you have no intention of those things. The idea that you have no intention of those things and can guarantee that the other person has no intention of those things and that you're equally calibrated in this amorphous kind of no commitment, some commitment, weird commitment, no wonder people get hurt. I suppose now's the point to just touch base on the fact that I know that it's not just married people in the room. And by the way, we could just pause for a second and say it's also true that there are married couples in the room that are struggling sexually. And whether it is to receive counseling and help, to be reading, to be finding ways to address what's going on in your life, I think the baseline promise here is that healthy sexuality will make your marriage better. It will make your marriage better. Those things go together, good marriage and healthy sexuality. Of course, there are plenty of people in the room that are not married. And the question comes, how do you navigate this world where, frankly, as you look at our development as human beings in our bodies, we gain kind of the capacity to be sexually active at 11, 12 years of age. Some suggest that we're not actually mature adults until 24, 25, 26, some 12 years later. How do you navigate that time? How does this work? I'm aware of some research that was conducted here on campus some time ago, not that long ago actually, that I think is kind of interesting on the subject. The question asked of our Andrews students, have you had sex in the last 12 months? There's good news and bad news here. 30%, about 1 in 3 of our Andrews University students say, I've engaged in sexual activity sometime over the last 12 months. And that's a large number. And you know, I hope you're realistic about this. We would have no reason to expect that the numbers would be any different here in this room. The good news, if you want to call it that, in comparison to fairly similar age groupings in a study by the Center for Disease Control, suggests that almost 60% of young people age 20, 22 would be saying, yes, I've engaged in sexuality in the last 12 months. So it's obviously a lot less. And I'm not sure how much better that makes me feel about the conversation. And I realize that on this subject, we could split people into groups there too, right? I mean, there are people who actually right now would want to argue, look, it's good for me. I don't care. I'm not doing that commitment thing that you're talking about. Others in the room would say, I this happened and it was a mistake and I feel guilt and I've prayed for forgiveness and I've worked my way through. Others in the room would just struggle to talk about it, Here's an interesting truth. In asking these same students, do you think this activity is okay to engage in? Specifically on the part of young women, more young women in that study on our campus were engaged in sexual behaviors than were willing to say it was okay to be engaged in sexual behaviors. Well, we regularly focus in our conversations with young men about the fact that, you know what, yes is yes and no is no, and you know, there, you know, it doesn't matter if, and if they're inebriated, no doesn't even mean no, and you need to be careful about hurting a young lady. And I wonder what the conversation should be around the idea that even yes might mean yes, but I don't particularly think this is the right thing to do, and I'm going to feel guilt about it tomorrow. And maybe for a long time, that I will deal with, maybe in a way you won't. And if we were real men worried about the young ladies in our community, maybe we would be suspicious that they feel pressure to look pretty, that they feel pressure to say yes, that they have a need to be accepted, that we should protect. But I know this isn't an easy conversation. And you know what? If nothing else, if you didn't get anything else from today or don't, the Colemans, I just am so thankful that they were willing to share from their story. If you think of nothing else, young person, especially those of you that have made sexual mistakes or have been walking a path that you feel guilt over, maybe even shame over, you've been told not to do this and you believe that you're wrong in doing this, I hope you'll hear me clearly right now. Because this is a tough conversation to have, because on the one hand, it maybe sounds like if we say it a certain way, well, what you do, it just doesn't matter. It's not a big deal. There's forgiveness, and it's going to be okay. Or on the other hand, you're going to hell. Your life's going to be awful. You'll never have a successful relationship. And we kind of ends up being in those two camps somehow. But there's this place in the middle that I want to take you to that says this. If you engage in sexuality outside of marriage, I believe you will pay a price. The price can vary in some ways, kind of like somebody who chain smokes a little bit, right? Everybody knows some 85-year-old chain smoker. See? It's great. So you could look at a lucky situation or scenario here, but there are far more stories of the pain and the challenge and the difficulty and all that there is to overcome. I believe if you're sexually active outside of marriage, you will pay a price, and you will likely not understand the price when you walk out of the store with it. But let me tell you what in price you should not be paying. And that is the price of feeling judged or not accepted. If you don't get anything else out of the Colemans story, understand, as you look at adults 40, 50, 60, 70, we know what it's like. We have made some of these same mistakes, and we have paid prices that we're often unwilling to even tell you about. But we don't want you to feel judged. Neither do we condemn you. You're in the right place. But if there's anything we could do to help you take your future seriously. We would want to do that. Because we have gone down that road. And we do understand what it is like. And sooner or later, most young people that I talk to, they want to create an exception or a situation. Well, but what if we're engaged and we're about to get married? And I'm going to marry. If I knew for sure I was going to marry, then it's not a problem. Yeah, okay. Can you imagine? See, when we engage in things that we know to be wrong or we believe to be wrong, it goes into a different category than all those things that are lining up with, for instance, the whole oxytocin idea of drawing close and becoming one. That is supposed to be about safety and commitment and togetherness and oneness. And then on this other hand, we have this thing of reservation and danger. And in fact, you know, there are other kinds of endorphins that are released when we do things that are dangerous, right? Some people get quite addicted to it and cause them to end up being, and maybe some people are just born this way, but they want to jump off of buildings with next to nothing, maybe a little wing thing happening between their arm and their body and glide down to earth. And you got to keep stepping that up, stepping that up, stepping that up. I've often wondered how in the world anyone ever gets to the place of some of the sexual depravity that is available in the world today. How does somebody end up there? I suspect it's because they started doing something they knew to be wrong, and then that was exciting. And it gave them some thrill. And you know what? Doing it the right way doesn't give you that same thrill, and so you got to go back to that. But you can't do it the same way because now that's regular. So you got to step into something a little bit further, a little bit further. Next thing you know, you got to be doing this in public or with three people or with, you know, whatever. Can you imagine, young man, having committed to and married the most wonderful young woman in the world, but there's something that feels missing because it's not quite dangerous enough? Can you imagine? And I can't help but think through the perspective of a young man. Can you imagine if you take that situation with a young couple where they're engaged to be married, and it gets so difficult not to be active sexually when this is the person and she said yes, and here's the wedding date anyway. But I don't know that this for sure will happen, but what if what happened was, in fact, your wife-to-be then began to associate sexual activity with guilt and shame? Guys, you know, somebody walks, you know, our wife walks by us. I was going to say in just the right kind of clothing. Skip that. Our wife walks by us, and we could be sexually interested because we're so visual. Most women, it takes a different path. It takes more wooing. It takes a little longer. It's a bit more of a little journey. And what if steps along the way in that journey have a little voice saying you should be ashamed? Are you willing to pay the price of that affecting some years of marriage, even if you can gain victory, even if that can be overcome, even if that would go away for a few weeks or months now? Really? I'm just wanting to say to you, God knows what he's talking about. So on the one hand, one, we do not condemn you for whatever you've been going through. We could come up with a 50-year-old example of it by somebody who had the courage and guts to stand up and talk about it in this room right now. We understand the journey. On the other hand, we do want to say this matters. This really, really matters. And you deserve to have the most awesome, amazing, fulfilling sexuality and marriage on the planet. Somewhere in between those two comments, I do need to say, Jesus Christ loves you. And no matter what you've ever done, the forgiveness of the issue is already taken care of. It's about you claiming it and taking it for yourself. And we, those of us married, those of us who've been through different experiences, we need to be carriers, dispensers of forgiveness. people you could come to and know by the end of that conversation, I can be washed clean. Doesn't mean you won't pay a price, but you can be clean. You can be clean. This conversation, and it goes through quite a number of interesting little twists and turns. There's that point at which in chapter 8, for the third time in the book of Song of Songs, in chapter 8, the writer says, verse 4, daughters of Jerusalem, I charge you, do not arouse or awaken love until it so desires. Do not awaken love until it is time. And so I ask each of you, what time is it for you? If you are married, you owe it to your spouse to pursue great sexuality. If you are not married yet and you are looking, you owe it to yourself to set yourself up for the best possible sexuality. Whether that is halting something, seeking forgiveness, overcoming shame and guilt, changing lifestyle, looking for people who espouse the values you hope for in your marriage. This last little bit of chapter 8 as we close today, I just want to say to you, I just deeply, deeply love my family. I am just so in love with my wife. I'm proud, as much proud of any accomplishment, I am proud of the fact that my children, I believe, have a clear sense of how attractive I find her to be. In my house, in fact, my kids know it's kind of a rule for me. I take being head of the household quite seriously. And so now I have all three of my kids are in that adult or just pre-adult stage. And so they all know this. They all know that when it comes to affection, I intend to be in the lead. And so when it comes to acts of physical expression, they know, just, hey, plan carefully, because whatever level you take it to, I know I got to get, I'm going to top that, okay, somehow. And if that makes you feel awkward, well, you should have thought that through before. And if you don't think I have experience to get me over that section where you think you are, I do. I can get this job done. Don't worry. The question is whether my wife will still be happy with me or not. But so, yeah. I deeply, deeply love my wife, and I am not embarrassed to say I'm as fulfilled as ever in my life. In every way I can imagine to describe to you. And I just believe God has that for you if you plan carefully and if you're willing to wait on him. I want to read, and as I read, quite honestly, I'll be reading specifically to my wife from Song of Songs, chapter 8. I became aware recently over the last little while that my wife has a fear. And the fear is that she would die and that I would move on. And that I would remarry. Now, she's never shared that she thinks that's inappropriate or wrong. It just is a very sad, sad thought to her. And I don't know why she would think that she would pass on before me. But I don't know entirely what to say about that or to her on that, except that as I read this scripture, it reminded me of that fear and that worry, and so I want to read this to her. In chapter 8 of Song of Songs, verse 6 says this, place me like a seal over your heart, like a seal on your arm, like a promise, a deep, deep commitment. For love, my love is as strong as death. Its jealousy unyielding as the grave. It burns like blazing fire, like a mighty, mighty flame. Many waters cannot quench love. Rivers cannot wash it away. If I were to give all the wealth of my house or the world compared to my love for you, it would be nothing. Our love is stronger